ashes drove into where prayer points. Almighty everlasting God, it's again that we, your people, gather here at this your holy place. Dear God, we come acknowledging that you are God, and beside you there is none other. Lord, we thank you that you're the same from everlasting unto everlasting, that there is not a shadow of turning in you. You're dependable, you're trustworthy, oh God. You're worthy of all praise, all honor, and all glory. You are the great creator. You are the great I am. You are God all by yourself. There is none like you. You're the great Jehovah. We thank you, Lord. We magnify you. We humble ourselves in your presence, for that is our rightful place. We give you the glory. We give you honor. We magnify you. But Lord, we pray that you would speak to us now. Use your word to draw us closer to you. Use your word to make us more like you. Use your word to transform our hearts and to renew our spirit. Allow your word to penetrate our past to make our futures better. Dear God, use your word to bring your glory out of our lives, oh God. We thank you, Lord, for who you are. We thank you, God, for all that you've done. And we trust your heart and your mind, your hand, for what you will do in our future, in your presence. We give you name praise. We give you honor. We give you glory. It's in the matchless and eternal name of him who is yet alive, Jesus, who is the Christ, your Son, our redeeming Savior. We do pray. Amen. 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 Oh my God. God bless you. God bless you. We serve an awesome God. Give an honor to Almighty God, who is indeed God Almighty, from everlasting unto everlasting. He is God, and we pause in his presence to honor him. Give an honor to my bride of 39 years. Amen. My angel all over heaven, Julia L. Wright, I thank God for her in our life journey together. Thank God for all these preachers and all that God has built. Yes, it is talented. For each and every one of you who made your way here that we could worship together, and those who are watching via online, I thank God for you. I thank God for my baby girl. I thank God for the gift and the talent that she is to the body and for her partner in life, the Reverend Gerald, the very back there. I thank God for him because they kind of held the whole thing together, held it down while we were gone. It was a marvelous. It's a blessing. It's a blessing to be able to go for an extended period of time and not have to worry if the ship is going to crash while you're away. And I just thank God for God using them and the whole clergy team to move forward. Because First Lady and I, we tune in twice a Sunday, every Sunday to listen, and there was some preaching going on up in here. Oh my God. So I just took a little notes from Mary's sermon. But I thank God for what he has done. But as always, I'm going to invite you and encourage you to come on and see Jesus with me. Because I still believe if we can see him, we can make it. If we can see him, it's hard, it's crazy, it's difficult. There's a whole bunch of different messaging going on out there. People have no problems lying just to take advantage of you and to mistreat you. There's no issues anymore about hurting someone. But we have a God who's a way-making God, a God who will look out for us. If we dare to follow him, he'll bring us through. He'll get us through. He is a way-making God. He is. He'll take what the enemy meant for evil and use it for our good. He'll do it. They'll think they got over and all they've done is helped you out. Because our God is a good God, he's just like that. He's just like that. So, if you have your Bibles, come on with me. Let's go to the Gospel according to Luke. St. Luke's Gospel, chapter 4. And we're going to see if we can learn today from our Lord's journey. Luke 4, beginning at verse 1. It says, Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led by the Spirit in the wilderness for 40 days, being tempted by the devil. And he ate nothing during those days. And when they were ended, he was hungry. The devil said to him, if you are the Son of God, command this stone to become bread. And Jesus answered him, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone. And the devil took him up and showed him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time, and said to him, to you I will give all this authority and this glory, for it has been delivered to me, and I give it to whom I will. If you then will worship me, it will be yours. And Jesus answered him, it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only shall you serve. And he took him to Jerusalem and set him on the pinnacle of the temple and said to him, if you are the Son of God, throw yourself down from here, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you to guard you, and on their hands they will bear you up, lest you strike your foot against a stone. And Jesus answered him, it is said, you shall not put the Lord your God to the test. And when the devil had ended every temptation, he departed from him until an opportune time. Praise our God. Just for a little while, I want us to consider together the thought, managing the tension. The world that we find ourselves in is one where you can often cut tension with a knife. It seems that everyone is moving in different directions and colliding into each other. Every opinion is stressed and challenged and pulled on by another. No matter what news outlet or feed you read or listen to, is always a twist or a turn that leads you in a direction that you're not quite sure which way to go. But all the tension in the world that's going on out there, it really pales in the face of the tension that happens in us. You see, it's that internal tension that really creates the problem. It's the internal pull and thrusting and with oneself, the non-ending debate on one's ability and worth and value and what you think and what you feel and who you are. That conversation that happens within us when no one really knows. We can be in a crowd and have it, or we can be by ourselves and have it. It doesn't really matter what's going on around us at work or at home. The conversation still happens the same way within us. Who are you and what right do you have? And are you good enough? And what did you do that for? It's all of that stuff that happens inside of individual that creates this tension. You see, because tension is really just when two or more diverging forces are forced to be united. It's when these who want to move in different directions are tattered together. It's you want to go left, you want to go right, but left and right is tied together. You don't know which way to turn because it's there, and it creates a pull. It creates a tension. It's tight, and it's there, and it's that place of tension where we find our distress. It's that place where you're not sure which way to go, but and you don't, inside of you there's this pull, this tug, trying to get you to go one way or the other. And I suggest to you that that's what the enemy has done for us. He has created in us a tension, or yet he takes advantage of the tension that is within us, because our tension that we have to deal with is the tension of our human desire trying to conflict or relationship with trying to be a true disciple. It's what I desire in my humanity versus what Christ requires if I'm going to serve him. What I want to do and what I feel like doing and what God obligates me to do. It creates a tension, and anybody who tells you that they have worked that tension out, they're not telling you the full truth. You see, we can come to a place where we can work it out for a moment, but the devil is an opportunistic. He opportunist. He comes with an opportune time to mess with us. The Bible says here that we can see that he took two opportunities. One was a 40-day journey, and one he waited on that we didn't necessarily hear about in this text. So the Bible says for 40 days he tempted Jesus. And when Jesus showed him he wasn't going to fall, the Bible said that the devil left him for a more opportune time, which means he didn't leave him alone for good. He had plans on coming back. So just because I get over this hurdle don't mean I'm not going to be confronted with another. Just because I resist the devil today don't mean he's not going to come and challenge me tomorrow. Because the devil plays on this thing called tension in our lives. So he was trying to get the master to do something that he just wouldn't do. He was trying to get Jesus to put or place his humanity over his divinity, or his divinity over his humanity. See, in other words, the tension inside Jesus was the tension between being fully human and fully divine. It was at that point, that place, where divinity and humanity are tattered together, that's where the enemy came to attack. You see, the enemy will attack you at the place where he perceives your greatest weakness. So if I'm weak over money, if I'm weak over self-respect, if I'm weak over relationships, the enemy will wait until he sees that there's a moment of weakness, and then he'll come. We have the problem of many times blaming the devil for what life does. See, we like life brings us problems and situations, and we'll say that the devil did it. We have a flat tire and we say it was the devil. We burn the bread and we say it was the devil. We late for work and we say it's the devil. No, you just got up too late, you let the bread cook too long, and you ran over a nail. It wasn't the devil, it was life. Life happened. See, when you blame the devil for everything, you miss it when he really works. If you blame the devil for stuff that he didn't do, you miss it when he is doing something. See, the Bible says at the end of the 40 days, Jesus was hungry. The devil didn't make him hungry. Life made Jesus hungry. Jesus didn't eat for 40 days. As a natural result, he was hungry. Life happened. But it's at that point when life happens that the devil comes in and starts to attack. Okay. See, if Jesus had blamed the devil for making him hungry, he would have possibly missed the real situation when the devil attacked him. All right. When life happens, you can't just assume that it's the devil, but watch out, because when you start feeling that tension in your life, that's the place where the devil stands and tries to separate you. See, if the devil could have gotten Jesus to place his humanity over his divinity, or his divinity over his humanity, Jesus would have contaminated both. Both his divinity and his humanity would have been in trouble if he could have got him to elevate one at the expense of the other. If Satan could have got Jesus to act more human than divine, so much on our humanity that we forget that we're supposed to be disciples. And we can't be focused so much on discipleship that we forget that we're living in a human world. See, there's tension all over the place. Does Black Lives Matter? Is it a good organization? We focus so much on what can you get saved at, and that's the way. Yes, you get saved, but what about the folk who are dying in the street? But then we focus so much on folk who are dying in the street, we forget to preach the gospel. You need to be saved. We got to hold them together. We got to be holding together. If we don't, then we run the risk of turning stone into bread. If we don't, we run the risk of jumping off the temple and expect God to grab us. We gotta hold them together. I gotta say it's wrong to put your knee on someone's neck. But if you get saved, God will forgive you. There has to come together. That Jesus Christ is the only way. He's the only way. We have to hold it. Now get it, walk with me. Because what I want you to see is it's not so much what the devil asked Jesus to do.
Alright.
It's the purpose in which he asked him to do it.
Okay.
Alright. See, for you Bible readers, you know that that God worked a miracle. For 40 years he fed the folk in the wilderness with manna from nowhere.
Okay.
They just woke up in the morning and there it was.
Right.
When they complained, he gave them meat from somewhere, but they didn't know where.
Right.
Birds just flew in and said, here we are. God worked a miracle to feed them for 40 years.
Right.
Those of you who read your Bible, you know that Jesus worked a miracle to feed 5,000 plus women and children from just two fish and a few loaves of bread.
Right.
And then another same way he fed, did the same thing for 4,000 plus people. He worked miracles to feed people.
Right.
So now, he can't work a miracle to feed himself.
Woo.
He can't work a miracle to make a biscuit.
Right.
The issue wasn't the miracle. The issue was the purpose for which he would have made the miracle. The issue was that Satan wanted him to deny God. Satan wanted him to put his humanity before his responsibility. Satan wanted him to lift his divinity over his mission to God.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You have the power to do it. You have the strength to do it. If you're the Son of God, do it. What is he doing? He's challenging. He's challenging Jesus.
Yeah, yeah.
How does he challenge? Well, Jesus challenges, say what he challenges us. You see, every temptation, we call this the temptation of Jesus, when Jesus gets tempted in the wilderness. But it's only a temptation because it challenged Jesus' wanting.
All
right, if it don't challenge your wanting, it's not a temptation.
Come on.
See, you cannot tempt me with something that disgusts me.
Okay.
I don't want it.
Okay. It's
not attractive. It's but give me something that I have an appetite for. Parade something in front of me that wakes up my senses and makes me tingle a little bit. Now you have something you might be able to tempt me with. But the only way you can tempt me is you got to find that point of tension between my humanity and my discipleship. Now you're asking me the question, are you going to please yourself? Or are you going to please God? Are you going to satisfy your desire? Or are you going to lift up the master? Are you going to do God your will or God's will? See, that's where the tension comes from. So the truth of the matter is Jesus was hungry. Now, not just hungry like you get hungry when you miss breakfast.
Okay.
Not just hungry like you are hungry when you're in college and you ain't had a good meal in about 2 months. Not that kind of hungry. The kind of hungry Jesus talking about is the kind of hungry that happens after 40 days of not eating. It's called starvation. The Bible, the science tells us that somewhere between 3 and 7 days of not eating, the process of starvation happens. And you can live at a varying amount of time, some 2 months, some 40 days, but have us at the end, which means Jesus was at the end. So at the end of the process of starvation, the process where your organs start shutting down, where your body has consumed so much of itself that there's nothing left for it to consume it, and your kidneys and your liver and your pancreas and your heart all start closing down because your body is demanding food and it can't find it anywhere. It don't have the energy to keep running. Jesus is starving. He's at the end of physical life. At the end of physical life. And he has the power to remedy his own problem. He has the ability to fix his physical condition. All he got to do is turn the stone to bread. And it reverses the process. Starving to death in a bad situation and got the devil in his ear saying, if you are who you say you are, if you can do what you say you can do, if you believe what you say you believe, if you have the relationship that you say you have, then fix your problem. Pull yourself up. See, that's what we say. I gotta do it because I can. This is what the Lord wants for me. No, the Lord wants obedience for us.
Okay.
That's why Jesus says it's sad. The man don't live by bread alone. In other words, it ain't all only about bread that keeps me alive.
Okay.
You see, we get to the fact that it ain't about our physical lives to keep us alive. Then we come to a place where we can trump the want to with a got to.
Okay. That's right.
You see, we challenge our, it's our want to that's challenged.
Yeah.
I want to do this and I want to feed myself. And you think Jesus didn't want to eat? He's starving to death. He wanted the bread. Jesus wanted to eat. But he had a got to that overruled his want to. My got to is I got to do my Father's will. I got to serve the one who sent me. I got to glorify God. And my got to overrides my want to. The problem with us, sometimes we get it confused. We get it backwards. We want to serve God, but we got to handle our business. I want to do God's will, but I got to make this money. I want to be faithful, but I got to do what I got to do. God understands what my heart. I want to be with him, but I got to take care of this over here. See, we get it confused and we put God with the want to, and we put our desire on the side of the got to. But that's how you fall. That's how you mess up. That's how you put a band-aid on a slit when your artery is slit. You don't put a band-aid on it. That's what we do. We put I want to on God. God knows my heart. God knows what I want. God knows what I desire. Yeah, but he also know what you feel like you got to do. I got to do me. I got to take care of me. I got to go to work. That's why folks who can't even go to work and not come to church, you see, they see work as essential and God is understanding. They say, well, God understands what I'm up against and he knows I want to be there and I would be there, but I got to go to work. Who's going to feed my kids? Who's going to pay my rent? You see, because we got that thing backwards. And we got, I want to pay my rent. And I want to pay my light bill. But I got to obey God. See, when you get the got to in place of the want to, then what happens is you bring your life in balance. Because it's only with Jesus, and because of Jesus was able to depend and know God's word and God's will, that he was able to hold his humanity and divinity in check, in balance. What did the enemy do that would try to knock Jesus off balance? What did he do? The same thing he does to you, my sister and my brother, the same thing he does. He tries to knock us off balance because he weaponizes our humanity.
Woo! That's good.
He weaponizes it. What you feel and what you desire becomes a weapon that he uses against you.
That's right. That's right.
Jesus was so hungry. Jesus wanted bread. And he weaponized it. And says, if you are who you are, then do it my way. Jesus came with all authority and all power. He's going to defeat the enemy. The enemy, he may not have known it, but Jesus knew how the story ended. He had the authority and the power and the grace. He was here to get it. He wanted it. So what did the enemy do? He weaponized it.
Yes.
You're here for authority? You're here for power? Then get it now.
Yeah.
He used it against him.
Yeah.
He weaponized it. His relationship with God, he weaponized it. He said, if you are the Son of God, prove God will keep his word. You know God's going to keep his word. You know what God promised you. Go ahead and jump. The angels got you. That's what the Bible says. That's what the word says. And what did he do? He weaponized Jesus' understanding of the scripture against him. Well, let me show you how he does that with us. He recognizes your faith against you. Because when I say, but God's grace got me. And I know it does. So the enemy says, it's okay if you spend your time, money, because you know God's grace got you. It's okay that you messed up a little bit, because God's grace got you. It's okay that you say those bad words or you do this thing, because remember, God's grace got you. So what has he done? He's weaponized God's grace against us. So now we will act in a way that defies God, because his grace is a weapon used against us. He weaponizes it. He recognizes grace. He recognizes faith. He recognizes it. He recognizes forgiveness. How many times have you knew you was going to do something wrong, you asked God to forgive before you left the house? How many times in the midst of doing something, you knew it was wrong, but you say, God will forgive me?
Yes.
He recognizes the notion of forgiveness. Yes. So that gives us permission to go out and disobey God. And that's what he tried with Jesus. He tried to weaponize his humanity and his divinity so he would disobey and offend his Father.
Glory.
That's what he did. But look at how Jesus managed the tension. The poor was obviously there.
Yeah. Okay.
He is human. He is divine.
Yeah.
He was hungry. And he could have turned the stones into bread. The tension was obviously there. But what did Jesus do? Every time Jesus stood squarely on the word of God, he said, this is what it says. This is what God says to me, and this is what I believe.
That's right.
Now understand. Look at where Jesus is. Jesus is in the wilderness.
Yeah.
It says that the Spirit of God led him there.
Yeah.
But after he got him there, you don't hear about the Spirit speaking up for it. There is no other physical person, human person, in the wilderness.
Yeah.
The only thing in the wilderness is what's inside Jesus and the devil who comes to attack.
Yeah.
So the devil can get you spiritually bankrupt. When you get in your wilderness, there's nothing to fight with.
Yeah.
It's only what the Spirit of God, it was only the power, the notion, the knowledge, the commitment that was in Jesus that gave him the ability to resist the enemy. So if you can be so tired that you can't read, so distracted that you can't pray, so angry that you can't be a part of, all you're doing is the devil is waiting for you to be sufficiently hungry to challenge you. See, the Bible says he tested him for 40 days. But he didn't come with the knockout punch until Jesus was starving.
Come on, Master.
Life, the enemy will always pick. But he's not going to come to take you out until you're weak. That's why some days it's like, I can do this. I feel all right. Some days you think you can make it. Some days you're strong. Some days you even forget to pray. You feel so good. But then you turn around and turn the corner. And there the devil is. Why? Because he has waited for you to go to sleep in your own convenient self-alliance. That when he shows up, in my life, it's noticed that I'm sufficiently weak enough in his eyes for him to take out. I'm not tempted at points of my strength.
Okay, that's right.
Tempted at points of weakness. Now what I consider to be a strength might just be a weakness.
All
right. I can be so self-sufficient that my pride is a point of weakness in an attack. I can be so self-focused and self-centered that my self-absorbance is so, my narcissistic attitudes are so encapsulating of my life that's a weakness.
All right.
Yes, yes.
So here I am. What do I do, Jesus?
Yeah.
How do I do it, Jesus? Look at what the Lord does. The Lord keeps his spiritual equilibrium. Mm-hmm. He keeps his spiritual balance. By rejecting the challenge and the challenger,
okay.
The tempter and the temptation.
Okay.
And how does he do it? Because he comes from the position of who God is every time in his life. So the only way to get rid of the tension, the only way to get rid of it is to have your humanity and your discipleship. In Jesus' case, his humanity and his divinity come together in perfect alignment and obedience with the Father. That means it doesn't matter if I'm hungry and there's bread. Doesn't matter if I'm on top of the mountain and I see power. It doesn't matter if I'm on top of the temple and I've been challenged with who I am. I keep my eye, my focus, my attention on Jesus. Both my humanity is in obedience to him and my discipleship is obedience to him. And it's not always easy, but it's always possible. Personal story just happened to me and I'm done. My wife and I was on vacation. We was walking into the store. It was raining sheets. It was coming down. It was just pouring down. I had already let my wife out, closed the door. She went in. I went, I parked. I'm walking back with my big umbrella. It's a huge umbrella. And as I'm walking back, I see this young lady. She has like a three-year-old girl in her hand and a one-year-old boy in her arm. And she's trying to make it to her car. And they're all getting soaking wet. Like a heavy shower, and then here they come, and I got my umbrella, I'm dry, and my first thought was, go help, and then my humanity kicked in, but it's COVID, I got to get closer than 6 feet, she ain't got no mask on, it's COVID. I got to get close.
Yeah.
She don't have no mask. But it's raining.
Uh-huh.
She got two small children. What do I do with that? That's tension.
Yeah.
Now, I'm not telling you this story based because of the decision I made. I'm telling you this because I'm telling you tension pops up everywhere in our lives and we got to choose to obey God. What popped into my mind, however, is if COVID wasn't here, what would I do?
Uh-huh.
And if COVID is here, is God able?
Come on!
The question is, what's right?
Yeah. Yeah.
The question is not the presence of evil. The question is what is right?
Yeah.
The question is not the presence of danger. The question is what's right. And I took my umbrella and got all of 6 feet that I could get. I said, come on, where you going? She said, thank you, sir. I said, how far you got to go? She said, right here. I walked into the car. Another, I don't know, 50, 100 feet. She got in the car. What if I had not done it? Such a small price. What I'm trying to say to you is when you choose God, God is. But because I chose God, God said right here. Because the challenge wasn't to walk with her. The challenge was to obey God and do what he wanted me to do in her life. The challenge is not how far you got to go. The challenge is, will you go? Will you do it God's way? So manage attention, y'all. Live holy before God. Don't let the enemy cause you to lift your humanity so you're so mad against people that you won't think, you won't remember that you're a disciple. And don't be so focused on being quote-unquote disciples and preaching people's salvation. Everybody needs to be saved that you forget that your sermon fall on deaf ears if you haven't loved them enough that they'll hear you. We have to come to a place where they hear and they're infected because we are in the hands of the Master. So manage attention. Jesus did. Jesus did. Satan is not the temptation. He is the tempter. The temptation is in you. It's in you. We have to say, God, I surrender me, my humanity, my spirituality, all into your hands. I will do what you want me to do. And I will do it to your glory. God bless you. Let's stand. I'm going to ask folks if they want to give their life to Christ, but first I want you to understand what we just did. Some sermons are focused on leading folk to Jesus, and all of them, every sermon is worth the salt, has an element of God's grace and salvation in it. But other sermons are focused on helping believers fight on and be whole and healthy and healed. In this world, it's hard to determine what branch of the church is telling you the truth. Yeah. It's hard to know how much of the struggle out in the street should you be in if you want to be faithful in the house of God. And there's arm wrestling going on. And what I'm trying to say to you is each of us have enough God in us to know that we have to hold together our mission to this world. Look at Jesus' first sermon when he was called. He came to get salvation, but he said it is his to feed the hungry, to heal the sick. His first sermon talked about his mission to the world, but his very presence is his mission for the world. We are like him. If we are so for the world that we can get to be to the world, we're in trouble. If we're so to the world that we forget to be God's ambassadors for the world, then we abuse the privilege. We have to be both. We have to be human, a human reality, and discipleship. Let's do it. Let's be faithful. Now, if you've never accepted Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, I pray that you do so. If you're in this house and you've never accepted Christ, you may give your life to him. But if you've already, if you're not here, you're out in the world of Facebook or other social media, then I'm asking you to do this. Tell God that you love him, that you want to serve him. Admit to him that you've done it wrong without him. And determine in your heart that you're going to live life for his glory and for his honor. He'll save you. The words that you speak, they're important, but they're not the most important thing. The most important thing is you turn your heart over to God and you tell him that that's your mission, that's your purpose. So do that. If there's someone who wants to become a part of Hope Church, come, no, or raise your hand. You got to come to the altar now, I'm sorry. Raise your hand. And we can see to acknowledge you, you can become a part of this family. If you're again, watching online, you become part of hope, that we're asking you to just, in the comments, just let us know when someone will comment and communicate with you. Amen. God bless you so much. Love you. Talk to you soon. See you. See you at 11. Y'all come back. Two services. You might as well give them up. Amen. God bless you.
Amen. Praise the Lord. We're going to have our Holy Communion. We're going to do it a little different, but we are going to have it. We're not going to move the church. We're going to ask you that if you want to participate in the Holy Communion, just come and get the cup and go back to your seat. And then we will all partake together. So if you're in the house and you would like to be a part of our Holy Communion, please come and get a cup from the table. Go back. If you are at home, just go by row. You can start here. If you guys want to come right here. If you're at home, you can get your juice or crackers and get prepared and go do it together. And then come right on and get a cup and then return to your seat and then we will eat and drink together. Amen. I'm going to take this opportunity to read the church covenant and then we will pray. We will open our communion and we'll pray and take it together. Amen. Having been led as we believe by the Spirit of God to receive the Lord Jesus Christ as our Savior, and on the profession of our faith, having been baptized in the name of the Father and of the Son and the Holy Ghost, we do now in the presence of God, angels, and this assembly, most solemnly and joyfully enter into covenant with one another as one body in Christ. We engage, therefore, by the aid of the Holy Spirit, to walk together in Christian love, to strive for the advancement of this church in knowledge, holiness, and comfort, to promote its prosperity and spirituality, to sustain its worship, ordinances, discipline, and doctrines, to contribute cheerfully and regularly for the support of the ministry, the expenses of the church, the relief of the poor, and the spread of the gospel through all nations. We also engage to maintain families and secret devotions, to religiously educate our children, to seek the salvation of our kindred and acquaintances, to walk so respectfully in the world, to be just in our dealings, faithful in our engagements, and exemplary in our deportment, to avoid all tattling, backbiting, and excessive anger, to abstain from the sale and use of intoxicating drink as a beverage, and to be zealous in our efforts to advance the kingdom of our Savior. watch over one another in brotherly love, to remember each other in prayer, to aid each other in sickness and distress, to cultivate Christian sympathy in feeling and courtesy in speech, to be slow to take offense, but always ready for reconciliation, and mindful of the rules of our Savior to secure without delay. We moreover engage that when we remove from this place, we will as soon as possible unite with some other church where we can carry out the spirit of this covenant and the principles of God's word. And now unto him who brought again from the dead, our Lord Jesus, in power and glory forever. Amen. On the night before Jesus gave his life for you and I, he gathered his followers upstairs to an old upper room. He had a meal with them. He talked with them and gave them some final instructions. And then at the end of that time of sharing, the Bible tells us that he lifted a loaf of bread from the table, blessed it, broke it, and passed it around to those in the room with him. He said, "This is my body.
Hallelujah.
That's going to be broken for you." He said, "Eat it. Eat all of it." And then likewise, he lifted the cup and he said, "This is my blood that's going to be shed for you, for the remission of our sins."
Hallelujah.
That means they are erased.
Yes.
Not that they were never committed, but they are erased.
Hallelujah.
By the blood of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
He said, "Drink all of it." And so we take time here to remember what Jesus did, because he said, as often as you do this, then do it in remembrance of me. Because we don't ever want to forget the price that he paid so that you and I don't have to pay.
Yeah.
So we're going to take a moment and open our cups. We're going to pray. Gracious God, we pray that you would bless these elements, that you would change them from their normal use, that they might be a reminder to us of what Christ did. We pray, Lord, that you would forgive us for our sins, so that we would be fit to enter into this ceremony with you as we remember what you did for us. In Jesus' name, amen. Let us eat together. Let us drink together. Eating and drinking all of it. On that day, they didn't have a benediction, but they just sang to him. They went out to the Mount of Olives, where Jesus was later betrayed. So we have a world that we're going to go in. We don't want to be betrayers of Christ. We want to be true disciples and manage the tension. Amen? Let's stand to our feet as we leave this place. Thank you. Remember. Trust in Jesus. Father God, we thank you for this time, this place, this opportunity to share together in your word. Bless us as we leave this place, but never your presence. We pray for the tithes, the offerings, the gifts that shall be left in this place and online, so that you get the glory and the house will be taken care of. These things we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.